5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0.
When I had come down this hill, I had seen this creature cross the road. It would have ripped my locked door from my truck, extracted me from my vehicle, and there wouldn't have been a damn thing I could have done about it.
This thing, I got to notice in its eyes. Its eyes was real, real evil, real sinister looking. You know, the look it was giving me.
What are you reporting?
Jesus Christ, you better...
Sir? Hello?
Get somebody out here.
What's going on now, sir?
That son of a bitch is about 6'9", I don't know.
Do you see him now, sir?
Yes, I'm looking right at him.
Uh-oh.
Welcome to Bigfoot Hotspot Radio, Sasquatch Chronicles. I'm your host, Wes, along with my brother, Woody, and researcher, author, and friend, William Jeffy. Let's start the show. This episode is brought to you by Audible.com. Go to audibletrial.com/Bigfoot Hotspot for your first free downloadable book and your first free 30-day trial.
Tonight on the show, we have Doug from Pennsylvania. He has some encounters he'd like to share with us. Before you had any sort of account with the Sasquatch, what did you know about him? What did you know about the subject?
Really, very little. I watched Legend of Boggy Creek when I was a kid, you know.
Mm-hmm. How long ago was your first encounter?
My first encounter was in December of 1978. I was 17.
Okay, and was this in Pennsylvania?
Yes, I was out deer hunting, and we had no luck the first day, and I went out a couple of times during the week with no luck, and it was a Saturday, and that's the next best day after first day. That's when most of the hunters are out in the woods moving the deer around. Me and two friends, Nick and Gordon, went out to, it's called Coal City Road. It's near Oil City, where I'm from, and we went in the woods about, I think it was like 6 in the morning, 5:30. It was still dark. And we worked our way back in the woods about a half mile, and I stationed myself on this rock outcropping at the top of this hill. And it was a good visual sight. I could see 200 yards all the way around, and Nick was to my left standing on top of an old iron blast furnace, which was probably 60, 65, 70 yards, I'd say, away from me. And then Gordon was further around the hillside watching a good opening into the valley. You know, it's a nice valley. It kind of goes into a deep hollow at the bottom. And I'm watching the valley, not seeing nothing yet. About 140, I'd say, yards to my right, I see this guy come out and just start walking down through the woods. You know, I was sitting there, and it's like he had no orange on. You know, and I thought, man, what an idiot. Walking down during deer season, to hunt you have to literally be layered in orange, fluorescent orange type clothing in Pennsylvania, just to reduce the number of hunting accidents. And I'm watching him and I'm just like, oh my God, what an idiot. This moron's going to get himself shot down here. He's all dressed in black, you know, and he's just walking straight through like he owns the place. You know, I didn't notice any other hunters, but, you know, you just don't do that during hunting season. This is all post property to begin with, you know. You have to have permission to be here. I'm here now. Great. The owner's going to like hearing about this. And I'm watching him, and he's going. And it's like I looked over towards my buddies. They didn't see him. He was around the hill a little ways too far for them to see him because of the way the hill lies. They wouldn't have been able to see him until probably he got down into the valley about 150 to 200 yards away. They might be able to pick him out. I watched him, and he kept going. He was walking along the edge of the bottom of this hill that runs down. right side, about 200 yards away, the top of the hill is, and he kept going. He walked down, and he got down to where the, about where the creek was. And this creek's probably 10 feet wide. He just kind of started jogging down the hill. Within a couple of seconds, he was on the other side and going up. And I'm like, my God, how did he get across that creek so fast? And it's like, it amazed me. And I just really started watching it. I pulled my rifle scope up to get a look at it. You know, I thought maybe I might know him, you know, because I know just about everybody, you know, in the area, you know, hunter-wise, you know, it's a small community. I thought maybe I see who this guy is. I pulled up, and as soon as I got him in my rifle scope, I could see he wasn't wearing black. He was just covered in black. He was just fur, you know, the hair. I'm like, what the heck am I seeing, you know? It's like, I didn't really even think Bigfoot, you know? But right. Then I looked at the scope real close, and I'm looking, and I can see, you know, how much hair he had in the head and everything. His hair was longer around the head, you know. It's like, it just looked like he had long hair, you know, I thought at first, which back in those days, a lot of people still had the long hairstyles, you know.
Right.
He started up the other side, and I'm like, what am I looking at? And I'm looking through the rifle scope at him, you know, just watching him. I was just transfixed with this, you know. When he got right up the top of this little edge of a row of pines that run the whole way down the hillside, he just come to a dead stop, and he turned and looked straight at me. It's like, I never even seen him turn his head once the whole time he walked in there. And he looked right at me. I felt like he was looking right through my scope into my eyes, you know. It's like, he knew I was there. It's like, there's no doubt, just the way he stared at me. And I just got this chill run down my spine. I just almost started shaking, and I'm looking, and it's like I could see, you know, the expression. It almost looked like a grimace, or maybe like he was pissed off. And he looked, and then he just turned and went right into the pines, knocked snow all over the place, and just went right out the other side, you know, just kept going. Once he, you know, entered the pines, I lost sight of him, but I'm like, what the hell? I turned to my friends to see, and they hadn't even noticed him. You know,
oh, wow.
Nick was on the other side of some trees that are actually growing off of this iron blast furnace now from being there for so many years. It's accumulated dirt and leaves and everything. Now there's probably, like, well, at that time, there was probably 8 or 10 trees growing on top of this thing. And it's like, I just, what the hell, you know? And it's like, I was shaking a little bit. It made me nervous. I started thinking about it, you know, what it was. And it just, I knew at that point, I knew exactly what it was. I just couldn't believe I was seeing it.
When you were looking through the scope, what did the face look like? I mean, my God, what did you, I mean, I can imagine what you thought, but when you looked at the actual face.
It looked like a man, you know, for the most part. A man with a face of hair, you know, I mean, like beard, you know, I mean, his face was covered. His mouth, I could make out his lips, you know, I didn't see any teeth or anything. His eyes, they looked maybe a little larger, you know, than normal. But for the most part, it looked like a colored person, you know? You know how, like, boxers, you know, that have fought for a long time, you know, their nose gets flattened out, you know, and pushed in, that have been hit in the face a lot, they get that, you know, just the way their nose becomes? That's what it reminded me of, you know? Like, he'd spent a few years in the ring getting hit in the nose, you know?
Yeah,
but, yeah. It looked totally human, you know? And the mass of him, you know, I mean, it was probably... I'd say he went 300 pounds. He wasn't huge. I said it looked like about a 6 foot human, you know, maybe a little taller than 6 feet. But when he looked at me, it's like I could see just the way the expression was, almost like his forehead wrinkled up, like he was mad. And so he gave me this piercing look like, you're trespassing. You know, that's just the way I felt. I was trespassing on his property. I doused my hot pot, you know, and picked it up from the bottom so I didn't get burnt, and I was out of there. I went over to Gordon. And Nick was still on the furnace, and he hadn't even looked in my direction. I got over there, and when I got over to Nick, he was kind of pissed off because I walked away from my site, you know. If anything would have been coming, I would have disturbed him and chased him away. I went over, and it's like, Nick's kind of a hard individual, you know. It's like, if you share something with that might be embarrassing, you know, the whole town's going to hear about it because he'll make fun of you for the next 10 years. So it's like, I just decided when I was on the way over there, I'm not going to say nothing to him.
Yeah.
So it's like, I've kept these stories all in all my sightings in for like 20 years, you know. I was a professional school bus driver. I was a security enforcement officer. the jobs I had. I was bonded for $100,000 and bonded for $1 million, you know, and I worked for security. And I had a reputation, you know, if I started talking stuff like this, a lot of people might not want me coming in and protecting their businesses and such.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Parents,
you had to kind of protect your career.
Yeah. I was still 17 at this point, though, before I started to drive a school bus, but still I was a kid, you know, and you kind of, you think about your reputation, you know, it's like you don't want the girls and stuff to think you're nuts, you know, you want them to like you and take you out, you know, go out with you, you know, it's like you don't want to drive them away with weird stories, you know.
Right.
You know what I mean? It's
like, yeah, now I hear you.
At that age, yeah.
When you were looking at him through the scope, you said it was about 150 yards away?
Yeah, he cut across. It was maybe a little under 150, 140 or 130, I'd say.
I gotcha.
I had a nice high-powered scope. My dad sent me on my 12th birthday from Alaska, actually.
When you had your second sighting, what was the time frame from when you had your second sighting?
Well, that was in August of 1991, so you're talking 78.
There was a few years in between.
I would imagine between the time you had your first sighting to your second sighting, did you get an interest in Sasquatch? Did you get an interest in, I mean, God, you saw firsthand.
Oh, I had an interest in Sasquatch from that point on. I mean, a lot more than just from seeing the movie. It's like I was really, you know, thinking about it a lot, you know. It's like,
yeah.
I thought about that sighting for a long time. You know, every day I thought about it for probably the next 2 weeks, you know.
Yeah.
And actually, before that season was out, I went out to that same area, but I entered the woods probably 4 miles away on the other side of the valley, coming in from the backside. And it was actually the last Saturday of the hunting season, and I found an area that was actually what I could think now was just actually a large structure. It was huge. It was all surrounded by, like, berry bushes, 10 foot high, probably 10 foot thick, and just all briars. And the only way to get into this area was crawling down on your belly to go through a hole where I could see something that had been going in and out of. And it's like, I looked at it, and I just thought, man, there's no way I'm crawling in there after seeing what I saw, you know. It was just the Saturday before.
Tell us about your encounter in 91, your second sighting.
That was the scariest day of my life, literally. I had 2 weeks to go before school started, and I was going to go back driving school bus for the school year. And I'd been doing a lot of fishing, you know, just about every other day I'd be out in the woods hitting trout streams. At that point of the year, it's not really, the rivers aren't as good fishing, you know, so I do trout fishing again. You know, I do that 2 times a year in the early spring and then later on before the walleye and that start hitting. Walleye are one of the best eating fishes in PA. And you just, you know, you fish for different things at different times of the year, so in June, it was hot, and that I head back out in the woods, you know, where it's nice and cool. I hit native trout streams and stocked trout streams. And I went to the stream just off of Route 62, about 7 miles from Oil City. The first time I went there, I was like 8 years old with my brother-in-law, Bob, who taught me how to fish. And I fished that every chance I got from 8 years old on. See, at this time in 91, I was 30 years old. Born in 61, so I was just shy of turning 30, and I figured I'm going to spend the day out there, maybe get lucky and catch my limit, you know, get some brown trout for dinner. Probably 15 minutes, I had my first brown trout. It was a nice 14-incher, you know, and this is going to be a nice start to dinner, and maybe I'll get lucky and catch some more. Well, I worked the creek for about 500 yards, and I had caught 5 nice brown trout, all 14 inches. You know, they were all from that stocking in the spring. And it's like I had to keep picking my stringer up and moving it, you know, from hole to hole. Keeps the fish nice and fresh, you know. Wanted them good until I left. You know, I'd clean them before I left and headed home. Well, after fishing, I got about 500 yards down the creek, and I looked down on a sandbar that was on the outside of this bend, and I figured, well, I'm done carrying these trout all over. All I need is 3 more for my limit, so I jumped down on the sandbar. It was about 3 foot by 8 foot long, you know, it created, you know, during the high waters over the winter. And I took my stringer, and I pushed it into the sand, and I stuck 2 big rocks on top of it just so the trout didn't pull it loose into the creek, you know, and swim away. Well, I grabbed one of my rods. I had two with me. I always take two when I go out just in case something happens. I'm always good to go with at least one rod. And I left my creel there. I took the stringer out, and I had my little spinners on, and I was good to go. So I started off downstream. I figured, well, it's getting down. It was probably 7:15. And this is a real deep hollow. It gets dark down in there once the sun gets so far away. And it was starting to get dark, you know, back in these heavy trees. These were old trees, big ones. I started working my way down the stream, and I got probably 50, 75 yards away, and I wasn't seeing no more holes to fish because it was just too shallow. And I got down probably, I was probably 120, 130 yards away from where I left my stringer, and it's just like, I didn't see nothing, you know, and there was no way I was going to just keep walking. It was getting dark very fast. And I said, well, I'm done, and it's like, and I started noticing, like, I wasn't hearing anything anymore. The whole time I'm out in the woods, you know, you hear chipmunks, you see birds and everything, but I wasn't hearing a sound. And it kind of made me nervous. It's like I just felt uneasy all of a sudden. It's like, this is weird. I started looking around. I didn't see nothing, couldn't hear nothing. I just got nervous. I don't know. I just felt like something was watching me. You know what I mean? It's just, I'm sure you've heard that many times. I just got this chill. It's getting dark. I got a ways to go to get out of these woods. I don't want to waste my time here. And I just headed back up the creek. This is a windy creek. You can see probably 20 or 30 yard stretches until you get to the next bend and so on, all the way back up the creek. I managed to get up about 75, 80 yards back up the creek, and I noticed the water, which was crystal clear, you know, from the spring fed creek. You can get down in there with a cup and drink it. It's so clear. And I looked, and it was all of a sudden, it was just murky, brownish. What's going on? This is weird, you know? And it's like, I kind of knew. Something told me something was out there with me. I just had this chill. And I felt like someone was watching me. When I saw that murky water, you know, there's the only thing that could be, something's disturbing the water upstream. And I started moving a little faster because I was just getting nervous. I could feel it, you know. It's what people get, you know, when they know they're out in the woods and something's watching, you know. I got up probably about the last bend, 100 yards or so, and I come around the bend. As soon as I got around that bend, I saw it. Like the sandbar was just gone. It was totally gone. I could see rocks sticking up out of the water that I stuck on top of my stringer, and that was it. They were like 3 inches out of the water. And these rocks were probably 15 inches around, you know, diameter. I took off, I started jogging a little bit, and I got up right above the sandbar where it was. I tossed my rod down, I jumped down in the water, and I'm feeling all around, you know, looking for my string. And it was just gone. Like, what the hell? And then it dawned on me. Whatever took my trout saw me put it there. It was watching me. It had to be watching me the whole time. I got this chill. It went right up my spine. I stood up and I just looked all around. I grabbed my equipment up over the bank, got everything gathered up. I looked around. I didn't see nothing. Like, I'm looking all over, you know. Whatever took a trap, you know, it watched me. And I felt it, you know. I felt it was still there watching me still. I just started up the creek. I had 500 or so yards to go to the road, and I couldn't get there fast enough. I'm going, and I'm doing just a fast walk, probably about a little faster than a walk, but not a jog. I'm moving. I want out of here. I get probably 200 to 300 yards up the creek, and I just started feeling easy. It's like, okay, I only got a couple hundred yards to go. You know, it's like, I'm okay. There's nothing, you know, going to bother me, you know. It's like, I'm thinking at this point, bear, maybe, you know. Usually the bears, you know, if you see them out here, they're not dangerous. They run from you. You have more problems with a deer during rut season than you ever do with bears in Pennsylvania. More people are killed by deers in Pennsylvania than bears.
Right.
That's a fact. We've had several deaths in Pennsylvania from deer. But I started moving, you know, and I'm relaxing now, taking a breath. I remember I grabbed a cigarette and lit that, you know. And I'm going on. As I'm walking, I heard this thud behind me, really loud, and I turned around and looked, and I didn't see nothing. What the hell? Now I'm looking. I looked all over. I didn't see a thing. That made me nervous. Right away, I was back to the panic type fear, you know, because this noise was really intense. I could feel it under my feet. And it's like I turned around and I started doing a jog. Now I'm out of here. You know, it's like the hell with this. Whatever this was, you know, this is making me nervous now. I started going. I'm not doing a run. I'm not really jogging. I'm doing like an old army shuffle. If you've ever been in the military, the army.
Oh yeah.
It's a little faster than a walk. Yeah.
Airborne shuffle.
Yep, the army shuffle. And I'm going along. I'm wearing combat boots from basic training. You know, I was in the service, National Guards. And I'm going along. And I get about 100 yards further, and I got like 100 yards to go. And I'm looking up. You know, I'm looking around. I don't see nothing. And I could see the brightness from the roadway because the sun is actually reaching the road. And it's clear. You know, you could see sunlight again. You know, and it's like I'm starting to feel a little better, but I'm still nervous. You know, and I'm jogging along. And I heard it again. It was just like a boom right behind me, you know. And I turned around real fast this time because I was getting jittery. And I saw it. It was just like about a 12 to 15 inch diameter rock was rolling across the path right behind me, probably 6 feet behind me. And I turned to my left right away because it came from that direction, obviously. And right then is when I saw it. It was standing about 40 yards away in this row of trees. It was like 8 feet tall. 3.5 feet wide, and it's just staring at me. And it's like, I just started, my heart pounded. It went from probably 80 beats a minute to 150 beats a minute, like instantly. I just turned and I started running. And I watching it to my right as I was running. I'm watching the path because I'm like, oh, great, fall now. That's all I need to do. You know, and I'm running and I'm looking to my right and I'm running, and you know, it's like I'm probably 30 feet from the road, and I'm watching it, and I'm watching the path, and I'm running. I get to the bottom of the hill, and I turn to my right. The thing breaks out of the trees and just starts coming dead at me. And it's like, I just started panicking. I turned, and I ran up that hill as fast as I could go. And I got to the guardrails, and I jumped over the guardrails, and I ran. I was heading for the road, and I slid in the gravel and loose dirt. And I got right to the edge of the white line as this car just about clipped me. It was doing 60 miles an hour, and there was another one coming. It's like I couldn't go nowhere. I just made up my mind. I'm gonna get killed by this thing. It's gonna get me. I'm gonna watch it. I turned around and looked just to see it, you know, because I knew it was right at my heels. When I turned around, I couldn't see it. It's like then the panic really set in because it had to be right below the guardrails on the hillside. Just below my view of sight, and I'm standing there, I'm shaking, I got 40, 45 yards to go to my truck, and I waited and just kept staring, waiting for that thing to come up that hill, and the last car went by, and I turned and I ran as fast as I could go to the truck. I covered that 45 yards in probably 3 seconds. I got to my truck, and I threw everything into the back as I arrived. I just whipped everything, rods, creel, everything flew into it. I unlocked my truck and was in the door so fast, in one motion, I was slamming that door and locking it. I had the keys and ignition, started the truck, and as soon as the truck took hold and the engine was running, I popped the clutch and I was spinning tire all the way towards the road. I got right up to the roadway and just sat with the traffic coming. I just stared right at the guardrails where I came over, and I was shaking, literally just shaking. I never felt that kind of panic. Fear in my life, and I never want to feel it again, ever.
Chasing you, was it on 2 feet?
Yeah, it was always on 2 feet when I saw it.
What do you think its intentions were?
I think it was to scare me and intimidate me, because it could have had me. If it wanted me, there was no way it couldn't have got me. You know, it's like it had been watching me. I think it was just toying with me now. But at that time, I thought it wanted my butt. I thought I was dead, literally. It's like I never felt any kind of fear like that in my life. I've had scary situations happen. There's nothing ever to compare to this.
Everyone here at Bigfoot Hotspot Radio would like to thank Audible.com. Audible.com is the internet leading provider of audiobooks with over 150,000 different titles to choose from. To download a free audiobook of your choice,
go to audibletrial.com/Bigfoot Hotspot.
Do you think that it had every intention on getting you and the car startled it? The car kind of threw it off a little bit?
It might have been. That might have been all it took. But after, this was one of my habitation sites now. Since I became disabled 2 years ago, I started doing this on a regular basis. That's just, I've been going out to this area. That's my third sighting I'll tell you about going back, because I didn't go back in the woods for 20 years. Literally. I was done. I put my fishing gear up for trout fishing, and I never touched it again. I still have not been out trout fishing. You know, I wouldn't do it unless I was with a friend. Now, literally, I don't like to go in the woods by myself no more. I used to go out. I'd be out for 10 hours, 12 hours by myself, walk anywhere, go anywhere. You know, I used to carry a 9mm with me all the time. You know, I didn't have no fear. But if I would have had a gun that day, my pistol, I wouldn't have taken a shot at it. I don't think it would have done nothing with my 9 other than piss it off, you know. I'd have to probably empty the whole clip into it and hope, you know, it would stop it.
Let me ask you a question, Doug, before we go on.
It was big.
Ramona mentioned a story about a couple of hunters that were killed and stuffed in a tree.
Yeah, that was like, I was about between 15 and 16 years ago. There was actually 3 hunters. They disappeared while hunting, and 2 of them were found wedged in trees, 25 to 30 feet above the ground. And the 2 that were found in the trees, their rifles were smashed down below the tree. It just said in the paper, it was like a few yards from the tree, smashed to pieces. And both instances, the way it was worded, it was really suspect. It just didn't make sense.
How far away from that area was your sighting? Was it in the same general area? Or?
Yes, it's all considered President Township.
Okay.
It's all in the same area. It's 4 or 5 miles away, you know, from President Township. It had articles in the paper, it just said the President area. So if you were to look like on a satellite map, you could see this all just heavy old wood timber, you know, the whole area.
Right.
Did that story kind of concern you? Because, I mean, bears don't stuff people in trees and break their rifles like that.
Yeah, as soon as I read those articles, I knew, and it's like in my mind, I knew what it was. I knew there's no way. The articles said that they had apparently fallen from a higher level in the tree while deer hunting. It makes no sense. People build deer stands here in Pennsylvania. They have deer stands. They put them up in the trees. Back then, they didn't have the ones that you could set up, you know, take up with you and mount to the trees. You had to build one, you know, if you wanted it up there out of wood. And it said that they had died from injuries of their fall and became wedged in the trees. That made no sense, you know. It's like, people don't climb trees like that to deer hunt. It's just, I've never seen anybody do that, you know. It's like,
well, it might happen, you know, in some weird accident with one person, but you wouldn't expect multiple deaths from the same way.
Yeah, this was like over a period of 2 years that all 3 of these hunters were found dead.
The same way.
Was just, well, 2 were wedged in trees, and both times the rifle was shattered. So you can drop a rifle from, I don't know, 50 to 100 feet. It might break the stock off, but it's not going to shatter.
It's not going to shatter it, no.
No. Makes no sense to me. When I read those articles in the newspaper, it's like in the back of my mind, I kind of just had that feeling that's exactly what it was. First picture I came to mind is I think one of these fools took a shot at it, you know, and tried to, you know, shoot one, or maybe thought, you know, they're in danger enough to shoot it, you know, and just stupid, you know.
Maybe. Maybe, though, Doug. I mean, you weren't doing anything, and it charged you. I mean, it was coming for you.
I could see somebody, but they actually shot it to hurt it. You know,
Honestly, most hunters I know don't pop off shots unless they know what they're shooting at. I mean, I'm not saying all hunters are are that way, but I would say most hunters I know, generally speaking, they don't just pop off shots unless they know what they're shooting at. And a lot of times when you see a Sasquatch, you've seen them and how big they are, your first thought isn't, hey, I'm going to put a bullet in this thing. And you know what I mean? Your first thought
Because you know what you have isn't going to hurt it.
You know what you have isn't going to hurt it.
So like, first
makes you wonder why they would do that. You know what I mean?
Yeah. It's just like, it makes no sense, you know, to shoot something that big with a little deer rifle. I mean, okay, you get a headshot, you're lucky, you know, you might take it down. But if not, I saw a juvenile. It was one of my, I think which sighting it was Oil Creek State Park. It would have been my fourth sighting. Yeah, my fourth sighting, I believe it was, and it was running on the road. It was about a 180-pounder, and that thing covered 90 yards to 100 yards in like 3 seconds, literally.
Yeah, they're quick.
I've never seen anything in my life move like that, ever. I mean, it just amazed me. And as soon as I saw that, I knew if they wanted you, there was nothing you could do, you know?
Yeah, absolutely.
I don't believe they're out there to hurt us, you know. Actually, I just think they might be out there. If they had an intention of hurting you, it would be probably out of fear or protection for their families, you know, because they have young ones, you know. They're just like families, you know. They're living out in groups. I've started doing some heavy research, you know, myself when I became disabled, you know. After the years, I just developed a great interest in them, and I've been trying to learn as much as I can, and I constantly, my favorite habitation site is this site where I was chased out of the woods. I have permission from the landowner to go out there. This area is all posted. I have right now five hot spots that are very, very good. I find tracks, I find signs, I find structures. Every time I go out, I find something.
Well, let me ask you this, Doug. So was it after your third sighting is when you started researching the subject and started getting out there?
Well, I was doing a little bit of research before. Anything I could read about it, I started reading about it right then, actually, after 91. Any movies I could see, I would watch, and I'd look for any little clues and stuff to what to look for, you know, when I'm out. I started going back out, but I wouldn't go by myself anymore. I go out at nighttime. You know, I took a friend out to the same area, last August. Joe, I won't give his last name because he's embarrassed.
That's fine.
He had an incident when we were out there. We were 50 yards away from the top of this tree, you know, that was carried in one of the 50 trees I told you about. It was laid right along this creek bed, dried up creek bed. And we had a guttural blast at us from 45 yards away that it was very deep, very strong.
Was it a scream or growl or what kind of vocalization was it?
It was like a rump, you know, but it was so deep, you know, you could feel the size of this individual by how deep it was. He had some chest to him and he had some lungs. And Joe immediately says, I want to go. I said, Joe, that's what we came out here for, you know? I'm like, come on, bud, you know, please. And he goes, no, I want to go. And he drove, you know, which I said, Joe, please, and just wait, you know? And it's like it was only just on the other side of this dry creek bed, you know? And I said, Joe, please, just wait for me right here, okay? I don't want to go. I'm not going no further. I want to go. Just wait for me, Joe. Yeah. I said, Joe, come on, please, just give me a few minutes. I'll be back, okay? Where are you going? Joe, I'll be right back, buddy. Don't worry. Just stand right here. Don't move. And I took off. I went around, you know. Yeah, it's like I don't have the fear anymore, you know. It's like I gifted for about a year out there, and I'm very comfortable out there. Just something that I always do. If I know they're around, which actually they're always around. They always know when I'm there. I can feel them. I just pretend like and act like I have no interest in them, you know. It's like I just start doing stuff, you know, when I'm out there. Just so, you know, it's like I'm out there looking for them, you know, looking around, you know, trying to follow them. If I find tracks, I just look for things. But I took off into the darkness. The only light we had no flashlight, was the full moon that night. But I was comfortable with that. I could see good in the woods. I mean, it was dark, but, you know, I could still see good enough. And I'm moving along, and I get down around that where that tree was laying, and I could hear it walking ahead of me. It was probably 45, 50 yards ahead of me. It was staying just about 40 yards away and keeping that distance from me. So I'm walking really slow, and I'm going, I'm working my way towards the hillside, which is the way he was going, to the left. When you're walking in, when you walk into the woods, the hillside is to the left. It runs all the way around. It's that hollow, you know, one side of it. And I'm following it, and I'm getting into some treetops from the logging now. It's kind of getting heavy. As I'm coming up in there, I've probably gone 10 minutes. I could hear it just walking one step after another. You know, I hear the twigs breaking, snapping. And I got up there, and I stopped right at the base of the hillside, and I just listened. I was far enough away from the creek where I wasn't hearing the water run. You know, I could hear really good, and I just stood there and listened. And every now and then I could hear him just, you know, it was like about every 3 or 4 seconds you'd hear him just go, you know, it's like, I think he was just breathing, actually, you know. I don't think he was trying to make any sound, you know, that would intimidate me at all, but I could hear him, and he was just slightly up the hill, I'd say 30, 35, 40 feet away. And then there were so many tops there, I couldn't see it, but I started walking slowly, and I got up probably 10 feet away from this top. I could tell, you know, just by the sound of him breathing, he was just right on the other side of it. He wasn't moving, you know, at all at this point, and I just stopped. I figured, okay, I'm just going to have a waiting game with him. I'm standing there, and I'm listening. And he's over there, and it's like he would stop breathing. He's like, and he's just dead silent. And I'm trying to listen for him moving, and they're very quiet. There's just so many branches in this area, there's no way he could not move without me hearing him, unless he was going up a tree. And then all of a sudden, it's been 15 minutes, and Joe starts yelling my name. And he's yelling. And like after four times, I'm like, Joe, be quiet. When I did that, this thing just exploded up over the hillside. I could hear trees breaking, branches flying, and it's like stuff getting knocked over. I mean, either tree logs or whatever were rolling down the hillside behind it. It's like I couldn't see it, but I was just listening to this. That thing never stopped until it was out of my hearing. It went probably 3 minutes. I could hear it running further and further away till there was actually no sound anymore. And Joe obviously heard this. I mean, people 200-300 yards away probably heard this thing running up the hillside, you know, because there was no traffic on Route 62 at that time. It was just dead quiet. It's like I started walking back, and Joe's just dead silent, you know. He's not yelling my name no more. I knew he was scared. But
he's halfway home.
I worked my way around, and I come up from the other side to his right, and he's looking to where I disappeared into, and I'm coming up, and I got 35 feet away from him, and I said, Joe, and he jumped and turned and looked at me, and as soon as he saw me, he just started wiping the tears out of his eyes. He was standing there crying. I felt so bad for him for leaving him that long, but I got up to him, and I said, it's okay, Joe. I thought you were dead. He said, I thought you were dead, and I heard that. And I'm fine, Joe. No reason to be scared, okay?
You're lucky the guy with the car keys didn't get in the car and just go.
Did he leave me? Yeah. He wouldn't have left me. He went and went to the car, but at this point, actually, in the dark as it was, he's not familiar with the area. He was kind of scared to move. He was more afraid of getting further into the woods, not going the right way, getting lost. It's like, he's a city boy. He's actually from Pittsburgh. And he has spent literally no time in the woods.
Yeah.
He's a virgin when it comes to being out there, and he's just, I felt bad for him. I still feel bad for him. If I mentioned that to anybody, I mentioned it to his parents, and he got really upset because I mentioned about him being all teared up.
Let me ask you this, Doug. How did you get from this thing chasing you in the woods to reading stories about hunters being stuffed in trees to now you're basically tracking this thing in the middle of the night through the woods?
Being a solo researcher now?
No, I mean, just not really being afraid. I mean, this thing's like breaking branches, it's taken off, and you're going after it in the dark, in the woods, and just a few years back, you know, I mean, how do you get from, Yeah, how do you get from where at that point to, hey, I'm going to go track this thing in the woods?
Learning about them. You know, it's just, I don't have the fear of them anymore. I mean, excuse me, our area isn't really known for the aggressive ones like it is down in East Texas, Arkansas. They seem a lot more aggressive in that area. The Pacific Northwest, you don't really hear too many stories about them being aggressive in that area. I have friends screaming,
areas. They're aggressive up here. Don't let anyone fool you. I'm in Washington State. They don't mess around up here.
Well, here's something to consider too: is there's more than one variety. Everything labeled as Bigfoot is not all Bigfoot.
Yes, so there's several varieties.
Yeah, right, yeah. Right. And when you said that it looked like a man, you know, I stood less than 15 feet in front of two of them, and what I saw, I would never say was a man. It didn't look anything like a man. So very clearly there's, you know, at least two or three different types.
More of the ape characteristics then?
Right, right.
Yeah, wouldn't you say, we hear that a lot, Will, don't you think on the East Coast there has to be two different types? Because on the East Coast, like what Doug's saying, we hear that a lot. They tend to look more human than, and they tend to be a lot smaller than, would say, what
very
we
different.
Ran into on the Yeah, very different than what we ran on the Yakult Mountain. I would say more apish and at least twice the size of what Doug's mentioned.
Yeah, they're enormous out here.
They're enormous out here.
Well,
on the East Coast, I would say they're a lot like what Doug's saying. I mean, we've heard it so many times, you know?
Yeah, exactly.
Go ahead, Doug. I didn't mean to cut you off.
The two big ones I've seen, well, the one I saw that chased me out of the woods was a good 8 foot. 3.5 foot wide. I mean, he was huge. I would say 700, maybe possibly 800 pounds. It was big. I've had tracks I found 17 inches long, the biggest one so far.
Well, let me ask you this, Doug, and I really do appreciate being on the show. I wanted to ask you two final questions. What do you think Sasquatch is in your area, and what are you hoping to accomplish through your research?
They're very intelligent. They're not, well, in this area anyways, they're not just wild beasts that are out killing everything. They're family groups, family-oriented. I just want to accomplish and let people know that they are here. They are pretty much everywhere. And not to fear them, you know, when they're in the woods. I would like them, you know, I'd love it so they'd set up some protection laws for them so they're not disturbed, hunted, gunned down. Because these are the type of human beings that I'm seeing.
Let me ask you this then. How do you feel about the hunters that were stuffed in a tree? I mean, doesn't that kind of bother you a little bit? That would show me that there is kind of a reason to fear them a little bit. I mean, if they're stuffing hunters in a tree and breaking their guns,
you
know.
My gut's telling me something happened. Yeah, I mean, everybody has the right to protect themselves, but, you know, just like a bear. You can't shoot a bear out of bear season unless you're being attacked. You know what I mean? It's just, you have that right to protect yourself, and I see no problem with that at all. But I just don't want to see these hunted down, killed, just to prove they're here. You know what I mean? I've heard stories, though, where people were torn to pieces, you know, by them. Actually, that was one of the stories, I believe it was in your area.
I mean, don't you think that in order to protect them, as you say, you kind of have to prove that they exist? Really, for them to, you know, people, I know out here there's a lot of stories to where people have shot them. There's hunters that don't want to go on the record and say they've shot them. Through misidentification or through other means. And so they are being shot, you know, now off the record. And I think a lot of times people don't. I think if you look at all the stories over the years of them actually being shot, of people claiming that they shot them, I think one gets shot every 5 years, which that's kind of irrelevant, you know, because I'm sure those numbers are skewed. But even saying one gets shot every 5 years is pretty big. I mean, don't you think that if people are out there shooting them now, that they have to, don't you think it'd be kind of nice for the species if someone did bring one in, it is proven, and then there is protection, as you say, for them?
I'd hate to see one shot just to prove they're here. I don't know if the DNA evidence is enough for them to put laws into effect.
Well, I mean, how else are you going to protect them, though, if you think about it? I mean, how else, if you want protection for, and I'm not trying to be argumentative with you, I'm just, you know, having a discussion. I mean, if people truly want to protect them, but they're against shooting one, well, how else are you going to prove them? Because, I mean, people, you can have the best video in the world. I know Will's discussed this over many shows. Yeah, the best video in the world. It's either going to be called a hoax. It's video isn't going to prove anything. Like the Falcon Project. I mean, really, what are you going to prove with the Falcon Project? Not much. Good idea on paper, but in the real world, it's probably not applicable. You're not really going to prove anything with hair samples. I mean, we've seen that in the past. So, I mean, it's going to take a body. Like you said, unless we come across a dead body, which I've never come across an animal that died of natural causes in the woods, and I've been hunting my whole life.
It's rare, yeah.
It's very rare, especially in the Pacific Northwest. I mean, like you were saying, Doug, nature takes care of itself pretty quick. And so out here, I mean, I've never come across a bear that's died of natural causes. Deer I've come across, but usually it's from poachers, that sort of thing. I've never come across a deer that just got old, killed over, and died right there.
I found a deer with an arrow in it once. I've seen one. Yeah. Found a couple that were hit by cars. You know, and they managed to go so far. There's so many scavengers out there. It's quickly taken care of, you know.
But natural causes, it's tough.
Pardon?
I said, but natural causes, it's tough. I don't think I've ever come across anything substantial of natural causes that's died. I mean, it gets eaten up at her so quick. You know, I understand your feelings and not want to see one get shot. I mean, most people don't want to just see something shot just to see it shot, but when people talk about protecting them, but then they're against shooting them, I mean, they're getting shot now. You know what I mean?
Yeah, it's a shame because it might cause problems. It might make them more aggressive towards us and cause more problems.
Yeah.
They're very communicative. I know they, you know, they understand. And they have their own speech, you know. People have recorded them speaking, you know, several times and making their sound. They talk so fast, it's just so speeded up. It's like any wild animal, because they're living out in nature, they're wild, they see things a lot faster than we do. Them being wild, they're so much more perceptive than we are. I believe they're like, say 10,000 times more intelligent than us in the woods, you know, as far as living there, being out there. It's just, they're so much more smart. We could learn a lot from them. I would just like to increase my knowledge of them. And I would love to be able to prove how intelligent they are. This is my main goal. And so people understand these aren't just dumb animals. You know? That's really, right. I think that's really my most, that's priority one, I believe. It's a shame we can't set up areas for them, you know, more areas where you're not allowed to hunt.
Let me ask you this, Doug. We really appreciate coming on. What advice would you give to other researchers or new researchers out there?
If you're going out to learn, be aware, look for change. You're going to have to go over the same area several times to really notice any change. That takes time. If you really want to get into it seriously, pay attention. Take pictures of areas. Just set up a process where you go through and photograph a certain area you believe it to be a hot spot and just look for the subtle changes. If you want to see them, take pictures of any structures you see whatsoever, brush piles, and then study those pictures, videos, the back of them, because people are discovering things that are there after they get done that they never even seen. They were there, you know, when they actually did the video recording. They'll follow you through the woods. You'll never know they were there, you know, but they're that smart. They're that quick to react. I've been so close to them where I could smell them, and I looked, and I could not find them nowhere. And it's like they'd follow me all day, you know. And I'd be out there for 10, 12 hours. And it's like they'd follow me the whole time I was there. I'd hear twigs breaking, you know, and your branches snapping. Every now and then I'd feel something stirred. But
oh, it's been a pleasure having you on, and we appreciate you taking the time to come on and tell us about your encounters, and we really do appreciate it.
Yeah, we sure do, Doug. Thanks.
Oh, not a problem. I barely touched the surface of them.
appreciate you having you on and you taking the time to talk with us and tell us about your encounters. And yeah, so we really do appreciate it very much, Doug. Thank you so much.
You're welcome, guys. It's a pleasure to meet you all.
Yeah, it's a pleasure. Pleasure's ours. Mike Woolley sent me, I just got it in the mail today. It's a Skookum the Hunt for Bigfoot. It's this huge, it looks like a movie poster, but it's a magnet for your fridge.
Oh.
I just want to thank Mike Woolley. He signed it and said to my great friend Wes. And
yeah, Mike seems like he's a pretty good guy.
Yeah, Mike's a great guy. Mike's a really nice guy. We had him on the show. And actually, one of his encounter, I don't know if you've heard it, Will, but it's kind of a creepy encounter. He was hunting, and the deer came up and ran under his deer stand and laid down.
Uh-huh.
And these other two Sasquatches came out of the bush and caught sight of him. And they went behind a tree. And he took his rifle up, and he was trying to get a good look at him through the scope. And the minute he was looking through the scope, the Sasquatch started tripping out on him, started getting kind of aggressive with him. And so if you're out there listening, Mike, thank you for the Skookum magnet that looks like a movie poster. This is awesome. So I really do appreciate it.